Hello students, in this chapter we will study about the water transportation. So far we have studied about railways as well as airways, right? Now we'll see about water transportation. The water transportation chapter involves the following lessons: introduction to water transportation, advantages and disadvantages, harbor and its classification, accessibility and size of harbors, ports requirements and classification, facilities at major ports, planning and layout of ports, and finally the docking facility. So we have to read in detail about each and every lesson. So let's get started with the first lesson, which is the introduction to water transportation, advantages and disadvantages. So roadways and railways are common means of transportation and on land, while waterways are common since hundreds of years for traveling between two countries connected by seas or ocean. Air travel is common through airways. All means of transportation need place of approach for using them. Example, railway stations are necessary for use of railways. Bus stops are necessary for use of roadways. Aerodromes are constructed for using airways, while harbors are to be developed for the use of waterways. So air travel is heavily costly, though it covers entire world surface for its use, hence cannot be adopted as common means of travel. Movement of land is easy through roadways and railways, but areas available is nearly one third of the entire world surface land area which is available. So on the contrary, two-thirds of the entire world surface is covered by what? Water. So which proves importance of waterways or water transportation, right? Now water transportation, the historical importance of water transportation is making the cultural relationship and growth of civilization. All this doesn't need any discussion, right? Normally, your water transportation is divided into two categories. One is the inland water transportation and the other one is the ocean water transportation, right? You can see in the GIF here. So you have inland and ocean water transportation. So inland water transportation is either in the form of river, right, or canal. Normally river transportation became significant in 1855, and many commercial towns came into existence on the banks of important rivers like Ganga, etc. So in inland water transportation, however, we have certain restrictions and guidelines. Rivers are nothing but your natural water channels, whereas canals are nothing but the man-made ones. So this is about your inland water transportation. They have their own limitations. Ocean water transportation, this is adopted mainly for your trade and commerce, trading between two countries, right? It is estimated that about 75% of international trade is carried through your ships or oceans. So the development of navy force is intended for national defense on the oceans, right? Ocean water transportation has no limitation and it possesses normally very high flexibility. Now in 1853, when the railways was introduced, water transportation goes way back into centuries, but in 1853 when the railways was introduced, the water transportation got some setbacks, but it is still considered an important agency of transportation of either your men or material by our country, especially because it affords the following advantages. Now let us see what are the advantages of the water transportation. First one is what? It assists and provides a powerful means of defense in case of emergency of national security. So defense is one of the major advantage of water transportation. Second one is, it is the cheapest mode of communication or transportation, you can say. Cheapest mode of communication, because rail and road transport will require special tracks and surfaces before they can be made use of, right? But here in case of water transport, the natural waterway is a gift of nature. We don't have to build the route for your water transportation. So that's why it becomes a cheap mode of transportation. Moving on to the third one, it leads to an overall development. Overall development of the country. May it be in the form of commerce or industry or international trade, it will have an overall development. The next one is, it possesses high load carrying capacity. So very huge loads of goods can be transported from one place to another. So it has a very high load carrying capacity. This means of transportation, right? That is the fourth one. Moving on to the fifth one, it encourages consumption of foreign goods. Also, it encourages us to provide our goods to the foreign countries. Consumption and providing of foreign goods. So the people living in decent countries consume foreign goods like medicines, machinery, etc. because of this means of transportation. Okay, then the sixth advantage is, it requires cheap motive power for its working. What do you mean by motive power? Say, for example, if you take a wooden boat which is moving on a river or a canal, it will need a very small amount of exertion on the part of the man, or a small motor can be used for the movement of this particular boat. So normally boats require very cheap motive powers, smaller boats. Okay, so that is one of the advantages. Next, it has considerably helped industrialization and economic progress of so many countries, and the natural tracks like oceans, seas and rivers can be developed and utilized in the best possible manner. Also, it has helped to get the countries which are separated by oceans very near through what? Through the means of exchange of tradings. So the oceans now have been converted into highways of international economic activities. But it may be noted that at this stage, the introduction and development of railways in one sense has greatly helped the development of water transport, because the railways or the roadways will carry commodities from distinct places in the country to the ports, so that this can be sent to other countries, or the same way vice versa. So if there is some goods which is coming from other countries, it will come to the port, and then from the port it can be distributed throughout the country through your rails and roadways. So basically your rails and roadways are the feeder for your water or ocean transportation, right? So these are some of the advantages. Moving on further, disadvantages, or see the disadvantages of water transportation. The first and the major one is the slow in operation and consumes more time due to slow speed and movement of the ships over the routes. So that is one of the major disadvantage. The second disadvantage is, it is useful when water is available as the mode of transportation, and that too along particular route only. Say if water is not available on certain routes, we will not be able to use it. So water availability is one of the important criteria or the disadvantages of your water transportation. Next one, there may be a chances of accidents very oftenly. Because of what? Because of your ocean storms, hurricanes, winds, which will cause a great loss of the goods or the cargoes which are being transported. Okay, the ships also will have damages. So it becomes a very huge loss in that particular cases, right? That is one of the disadvantages. Then there are more chances of attack by the other countries on your naval ships, because around in and around that place or route where you are traveling, getting help might not be so easy, right? In case the range of tide is very high near the ports, what will happen? The loading and unloading of the commodities will become very difficult. Okay, so if the range of high tides is more, what will happen? Loading and unloading will become very difficult. Right, that is one of the disadvantages. And next one is the fluctuation of water level will cause what? Will cause the rubbing of sides of ships against the bridge. Wherever your ships are stagnant, no, there, wherever your ships are being parked, there will be lot of rubbing, through which your ships also will get affected and your bridges where you have parked them also will get affected. So that is one of the disadvantages. So if there are any mountainous rivers in the route, okay, or if there are any rapids or waterfalls, what will happen? This will hinder the movement of the ships or boats on your water transportation, right? So these are some of the major disadvantages which you can come across in your water transportation. So hope you have understood what is water transportation, what are its advantages and disadvantages. Right, next, moving further, we will see the classification of harbors. Harbors are nothing but the places where the exchange of goods from the land to the ships will take place, and this is the place where all of your ships and boats are stagged. Okay, so hope you have understood this lesson. Thank you.